recognized symbol of excellence in sports entertainment.
From the Sports Control Center, Craig DeGeorge with Lord Alfred Hayes, and we welcome you once again to Wrestling Spotlight, debut time on our show for the superstar Billy Graham. And Lord Alfred Hayes, for those of you out there who did not hear your comments, why don't we repeat these from about a month ago?
I don't want to, but I did say a month ago we'll never see him wrestling.
And?
He is wrestling today.
That's right. He's going against Terry Gibbs, a superstar. Absolutely incredible that he's back. I mean, it's amazing, everyone, not just yourself.
It really is. It's astounded me. Also, we're going to have another look at Ted DiBiase.
The Million Dollar Man makes another one pay his price. Koko, beware. Also, Demolition, a very good-looking tag team. And perhaps with Can-Am out of the picture now, they could be title people down the line. Anyway, let's get to our first match.
Accompanied by their manager, Mr. Fuji, from parts unknown, at a combined weight of 567 pounds, axe and a smash, Demolition.
Axe and smash indeed, Demolition. Both of these men well over that 6'5", 6'6" mark. One 305 pounds, the other one well over that mark. An awesome combination here. Just a question of time in my book as to when they will be wearing the gold, the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Championships around their waist.
What about the Islanders?
Huh? I don't see the Islanders lining up to sign a contract with Demolition's name.
Are you kidding? I've been negotiating with Fuji. He's just him hawing around all the time to me.
You guys haven't been negotiating too many things. You're all too upset right now over the Bam Bam Bigelow situation.
They're all jealous because I got the guy in.
Well, you said that. You said that you were proven last week. You came out and showed us that horrible picture.
Did anybody else
that
show
didn't
you?
Prove anything.
Did anybody else show you a picture of him? Any video?
No.
Then I prove
you
I know.
You weren't in the video.
I was taking it.
Oh. Wasn't a very good job anyway. Was it?
I had a cheap camera I had to rent.
Yeah, and the guy that you referred to as the little pipsqueak also showed the video as well. So it wasn't your own property.
Well, it must have been another one. You know what he did? He probably taped it off his VHS unit.
Well, that's possible.
When he saw me do it.
Well, right. He's capable of doing things like that. Reversal in, and in, and whoa! Smash misses a big right hand, and up over the top. Scott Casey only escaped momentarily, though. Snap Bear takes him over. Mr. Fuji and all the other managers here in the World Wrestling Federation laying claim to Bam Bam Bigelow. Fuji says he loves him.
Bam Bam Bigelow. Love Mr. Fuji Man. Love when Mr. Fuji Man touch opponent. Oh, and make opponent scream, scream. Even Bam Bam himself has goosebumps like Mr. Fuji.
Well, I hate to be the one to say it. I sure hate to say it, but Mr. Fuji is lying.
Sounds awful confident to me.
Don't I?
Well, you've never been known to lie, Brain, have you?
Well, thank you.
A real fountain of misinformation.
Yes, Fuji is.
Tag made. And Scotty got out of there. Steve Douglas now in a lot of trouble as Smash just dropped him like a bad habit. These guys are indeed awesome. Would you not concur? Even though you're biased.
Of course I have to be biased.
Oh, what a shot! By Axe, almost decapitating the youngster.
Week in and week out, they get tougher. They really do.
Oh, dropped him right on his cranium.
He pile slammed him. Or slam drived him.
Snapmare right over the corner. Look how nicely Demolition cuts the ring in half.
They are a skilled team. There's no doubt about it.
I'd like to see a match between them and the Islanders.
Islanders will have trouble with them.
You betcha they would. Complete disregard for any ability that Steve Douglas may have.
He has no ability.
Well, he certainly hasn't given a chance to show any. Look at the welts. Look at Look at the welts on his body that he's already gotten in this match. Oh, a left arm clothesline.
Or the right.
These guys are indeed awesome. Another quick tag made. Smash stepping in wide open. Ooh, plants one right in the lower rib area.
What's he wearing, Douglas? A barber pole?
Bear hug slapped down by Smash right in the center of the ring. Douglas up there. Look at this. Ah, look at that awesome move. What a leverage job that was.
I can't look at nothing where this guy gets hit in the neck.
That could have been Tama right there. Another double team effort as Axe on the second turnbuckle from the inside. Oh, another decapitation move.
I don't think we'll ever see Mr. Douglas again.
Goodbye, Steve. Oh, Fuji has to be extremely proud of that.
The winners of this bout, Demolition.
Indeed, Demolition now clearing the ring of everybody. Scott Casey, in fact, went out of there. They don't want anybody left in the ring. Let's go back and take a look at the double team efforts of Demolition.
Look at this. Look at that elbow. Almost took his head right off Monsoon. They're getting tougher, weaker than that. Could have counted to 15 there. 50, 150.
Indeed, it was certainly one-sided.
Hello, everyone. Big story here in the I Can't Believe It category. The up-and-rising Can-Am Connection disconnected. In an absolute shocker to everyone, Rick Martel's partner quit. Out of the clear blue, he just left, now leaving the defunct team's goal to battle the Islanders on the squared shoulders of Rick Martel.
Yes, when the competition got to be too much against the Islanders and my partner left me, quit on me, yes, I felt bad inside. I was hurt. But the Islanders, you're gonna learn a lesson that I'm not a quitter, I'm a fighter. Yes, I may be alone, but I'm gonna come at you 100%, even if I have to go through one by one.
All right, great to see Rick Martel's determination. Bobby Heenan and the Islanders, however, don't appear to be too impressed. In fact, they've been laughing it up these days, taking credit for the demise of their rival tag team.
Well, there is no longer a Can-Am connection. One of them got smart, one of them quit, put his tail between his legs and ran and hid. You see, Martel, you can learn a lesson. If you think you're going to go it alone, you're badly mistaken. If you think you're going to find a partner or even bring your parents or the National Guard or somebody else to help you, forget it. These are my Islanders, and they can't be beat. There is no longer a Can-Am connection. There's just a can, and that's what's going to get kicked, Martel. Your can.
Well, that remains to be seen. But we do know Martel plans to look ahead now to continue his pursuit, perhaps, in a one-on-one fashion against the Islanders. And who knows, if the right person is available, Rick Martel may again use his talents in the tag team division. With this special report, I'm Craig DeGeorge.
One call. Introducing in the ring, from Tampa, Florida, weighing 231 pounds, Terry Gibbs. The opponent, soon to be entering the ring area, from Paradise Valley, Arizona, weighing 268 pounds, making his return to the World Wrestling Federation, the superstar, Billy Graham.
We're on their feet here as one to welcome the superstar, Billy Graham, a man who they said would never return to the square circle, would never even walk with them. Look at him.
Look at those arms on. The size of this guy. I never thought he'd get out of that hospital bed. I never thought he'd recover. I thought he'd be living in the desert there swatting flies for the rest of his life.
What a specimen. Made a fool out of a lot of specialists, a lot of doctors who said it couldn't be done. He proved them all wrong. Former World's Heavyweight Champion, the one and only superstar, Billy Graham. He is an awesome sight.
What did you say, 24-inch bicep, 25 perhaps?
I don't know. They're up there.
They certainly are.
Must take about 7-8 hours to dress this guy.
Look at the physique, the upper torso.
Don't those people have any clothes at home?
The opposition, Terry Gibbs, doesn't want to be able to try and match power with that. Superstar with that look of confidence.
after the weeks and months of convalescing after that operation, and the thought in the back of his mind, the specialist telling him, resign yourself to the fact that you'll be lucky if you can ever walk again.
Now, this was a man that operated on him, gave his opinion that this man would never wrestle again, never return to the ring. All his medical knowledge.
An orthopedic specialist.
Right, and for some reason, this guy survived it.
Well, psychosomatic medicine sometimes can do wonders, man.
Well, I'll tell you one thing, he won't survive, though. I'll tell you one thing, he won't survive. And that's if he runs into any members of my family.
I'm sure he will. Why do you think he's returned to the World Wrestling Federation?
I know why he's back.
Now
exactly why he's back.
You've not only got to worry now about the former Olympian, Ken Patera, you've got to worry about the superstar.
Oh, I know they're friends.
You betcha. Graham unloading with that awesome power on Terry Gibbs. Referee saying you're on the ropes. He knows that. Irish whip in.
Whoa.
Plants an elbow right in the sternum area. He is like a machine in there. Very methodical. Double axe handle right underneath the chin. Gibbs went right to the esophagus. Look at this Gibbs now going to the top turnbuckle.
He'll drop an elbow on him.
Graham right there to catch him. And drops him halfway across the ring. Gibbs wanting to think this one over. Superstar, look at that trapezius development. Look at those deltoids.
Look at this, look at that arm and chest on him.
He obviously has not been wasting his time in the Arizona sunshine.
Oh no, I've seen him.
What is this? Gibbs, obviously realizing that he's under an awesome attack, decides to head to the locker room.
The winner of this bout, Superstar Billy Graham.
Superstar Billy Graham, not having to do too much to prove to Terry Gibbs that he is the superior individual. We'll be back.
All right, here we go again. I want to bring in a man who is a specialist. You know, you've got specialists in virtually every kind of business and sports today. Danny Davis, come on in. Former referee from the World Wrestling Federation. You were terminated some time ago by our distinguished president, Jack Tunney. You're now part of the Hart Foundation, and I must say you are doing quite well as one of the superstars in the World Wrestling Federation. You know, I said specialist. You are a specialist in the World Wrestling Federation. You are a specialist as an agitator. You agitate people. You upset them beyond belief.
The only reason a way I upset people, it's like when I was a referee, I did things my way. I went by the rules, but I made the rules my way. I did what I thought was right at all times. And now that I'm a professional wrestler, everybody's watching me, and everybody is amazed.
You say you did things by the rule. I'll take exception to that, Mr. Davis. In all due respect, I recall late last winter in Tampa, Florida, when the Hearts met the British Bulldogs. You were involved, actually, in that very controversial decision. And I've got to believe, if it were not for you, the Hearts today would not be the tag team champions of the world.
You know something, Oakland? You come out here, and every time a member of the Hart Foundation should win a title or should become, something good should happen to him, you have to come out with a controversial. Everything to you is controversial. Answer me these questions. Who is the Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion?
It's the Honky Tonk Man.
Who are the World Tag Team Champions?
The Hart Foundation.
And I'm not going to be an exception. Someday, Dangerous Danny Davis will be a title holder.
I get the feeling you don't particularly care for that moniker of agitator, do you?
Not at all, Mr. Oakland.
Just what I thought. I thank you, Danny Davis. And stay tuned. We're going to be right back.
Key band. It was not because of popular vote and pressure. Here now, a long look at the DDT.
You got me in a corner. You got me. I'm against the
The DDT, certainly one of the most devastating maneuvers in the World Wrestling Federation today.
This contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first to my right, from Houston, Texas, weighing 280 pounds, Outlaw Ron Bass.
Big bullwhip in there.
His opponent, from Downers Grove, Illinois, at 252 pounds, Leaping Lanny Poffo. And now, ladies and gentlemen, a poem from Mr. Poffo.
He calls himself the Outlaw. You call him Big Ron Bass. A tougher Texan I have never met. But he calls his bullwhip Betsy, and in case you wonder why, she might be the only date that he can get.
Whoa, watch out there.
I'm happy to see that. You know, I'm tired of Poffo has to insult everybody with his poetry, and Big Ron Bass is taking care of
business.
Wait
a minute. He sure is taking care of business here.
Oh, no.
Ooh.
Right on the floor.
Poffo trying to crawl out of the way. Ron Bass taking great exception. Oh, no, and a concrete floor.
Wow.
Bass beating the count back in, a slow count as it was. Big Ron Bass hammering away on Leaping Lanny Poffo. Now we suspect that Poffo would like to take back some of those words. Nice maneuver, however. Look at that, Poffo right back at Bass. Poffo trying to get the big man down. Drop kick, yes.
One thing Poffo does possess is a good right hand, and he can use aerial tactics.
Poffo slamming Big Ron Bass. Ron, get a rope now. Look at that maneuver. Now another one.
Whoa, I can't believe he kicked out.
That was almost a major upset right there.
Big Ron Bass kicking out of what was a very clever maneuver, but that one wasn't.
There's about a size 13 cowboy boot right to the chops.
Ron Bass in control of things. That maneuver.
That was a unique maneuver.
May have his man, he does.
Got him. I'm going to have to find out what he calls that. You got any idea what that is, Bruno?
Well, I'll tell you what, I think it's a version of a different version of a pile driver.
Well, Big Ron in there with that bullwhip. Wait a minute, look at that.
Whoa.
He's talented with that whip.
You call that talent?
Hey, to be able to sweep a man
off his feet.
Here is your winner,
the Outlaw Ron Bass.
Outlaw Ron Bass, and that bullwhip should be outlaw. Let's go back and take a look at this unusual maneuver.
Now, this maneuver, the way he did it, he got his head between his upper thighs, then he just leaped in the air and drove him down on that mat. To me, it is a form of the pile driver.
Ron Bass victorious. Here's some more special words from a World Wrestling Federation superstar.
All right, we're going to have him joining us here in just a moment. I believe he said he forgot me Tiffer. I would assume that's his hat, but it's not going to be long because he is coming in right now. He is from the northern part of Australia, just outside of Darwin. It's very warm in that part of the world. He's from Humpty Doo in the northern territories of Australia down under. He is Outback Jack.
Goodbye.
Right now, things are, speaking of heat, red hot at a World Wrestling Federation Outback.
Oh, mate, they couldn't get much hotter. Suits the weather. See, it's summertime over here, one of the most beautiful countries in the world, the place that gets all green. All the action and all the stars are here in the WWF, mate.
You know, you take a look at some of these great ones, and Outback Jack, you have met your fair share, I might add. Yeah, we've got a great champion in Hulk Hogan. Yes, he is.
The best. Absolutely the best.
The tag team champions of the Hart Foundation, and a man that I'm certain you have your eye on right now, the Honky Tonk Man, the Intercontinental Champion of the world.
Well, yeah, mate, the Honky Tonk Man, he sort of shake, rattles, and rolls. He wiggles his bum at the Sheilas, and I suppose some of the Blakes, too. You know, we don't sort of really know too much about the Honky Tonk Man. Practices his guitar.
He is practicing, I'll give him that.
Uses more oil in his hair than you would do to change a 1957 DeSoto's oil, you know.
Did you have DeSoto's in Australia?
Yeah, mate, we had a few out there just after the war, you know, the Second World War, and they rusted out a little bit because they weren't such a real crash-off car.
All right, now, Outback Jack, let's talk about some of the men that you see in the World Wrestling Federation. One of them has got to be Killer Khan, and certainly you felt the wrath of him when he spewed that green vial in your eye.
Mate, I'm going to call that the Mongolian mist. He sprayed this green stuff straight in the old eyes here, mate. I tell you what, I couldn't see for about three
days. You're still suffering a bit from it,
yeah,
are you,
mate?
Not?
The old right eye's a little bit sick. I need to go and see a doctor again and get it have a bit of a check out.
All right, you call it the Mongolian mist?
Yeah, Mongolian mist. Just sprays it like, you know, it's crook. It's like sort of being maced, you know, when the law enforcement's over, you're a cheeky bugger to a copper and he sprays you in the face with that mace stuff.
All right.
Not good at all.
Here's a very colorful man. He's out back, Jack, and we're right back.
Contest is scheduled for one fall. In the ring, from St. Petersburg, Florida, weighing 231 pounds, Barry Horowitz. And his opponent, from Union City, Tennessee, weighing 228 pounds, the Birdman, Koko.
No, that's right. My legs are too big to perch on a rope.
Koko, beware. One of the more popular athletes in the World Wrestling Federation.
And he can get the job done.
Yes, sir. That's the one really nice thing about Koko, Bruno, is after the music stops, after the dancing is over, Koko, beware, is a sensational performer in that ring.
Did you notice
indeed
how
he is.
Did you notice how Frankie was eyeballing that Federette outside the ring?
No, I didn't notice that.
Yeah, I caught it.
Horowitz.
Why not? Very beautiful girl. Even this? Frankie appreciates it.
Frankie may not be appreciating what he's seeing right now. Oh, look at that. Drop kick by Koko. Andre takedown. Koko with Horowitz flying through the air. The Birdman right after him.
Well, the Birdman's smoking right now, and Horowitz made a good move getting outside of that ring.
Koko, beware.
I think the key to wrestling the Birdman is definitely you got to get him off his feet, slow him down, and get him down onto the mat and hurt him.
Easier said than done.
A lot easier said than done. Later on, we'll be hearing from, I'm sure, a number of managers on their prospects of landing one Bam Bam Bigelow in what has now been termed the battle for Bam Bam. He's a hot property. How about that? That's a nice maneuver by Horowitz. Nice maneuver. Uh-oh. Koko behind him. There's one in your face. Scoops him up. Lands him down to the canvas. Koko. And Horowitz now whipped to the ropes, headed off. Koko with a nice back body drop. Where's he going?
He's going to the top.
Koko on the top rope. Look at, oh, goodness, what an incredible drop kick.
Now, why didn't he go to pin the man right there? Now, this is brutality right
look
here.
Look at this, the Ghostbuster. Oh, my goodness. You can count as long as you want.
That's right, but I think that's going in excess. He could have pinned the man after the drop kick. He did not have to punish him like that.
Koko, beware. And you best beware of the Ghostbuster. What a sensational drop kick from the top rope.
He gets up there.
Hanky and Koko getting down. Let's go back, Bruno, and take a look at that tremendous drop kick.
I'll tell you, I've never seen anybody do it quite like Koko Beer. Look at this, way from the top rope, he's up in the air, right in the side of the head. Unbelievable. And then from there, of course, he comes with his famous Ghostbuster. Look at this, and again, nobody does it like Koko Beer. I mean, there's no escape from that. That's it.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to my guest, Bobby the Brain Heenan. Bobby, I'd like to ask you about...
First of all, you don't call me Bobby. The name is Mr. Heenan. My friends call me Bobby.
Okay, Mr. Heenan.
What I'm going to do right now is I'm going to introduce somebody to the people here, and I'm going to give them an opportunity to show proper respect. So I want everybody up off them chairs. I want you to start bowing, and I want you to show proper respect. Because, ladies and gentlemen, making his way to the ring right now, it's the king of professional wrestling, Harley Race. Everybody up.
Traveling all over the country and here on television, ask asking people to bow. I think we'd all like to know.
I don't ask anybody to do anything. I tell them to do it. Right. I'll conduct this. When I come out here, we expect and I demand that you get up off your backside and show proper respect for the king of all wrestling right here. Now, what else have you got to say?
My question is, I think we'd all like to know here, why you deserve that kind of respect, the bowing.
Because I am the king. I am the man in wrestling today. I'm the man with the crown. I'm the man that can say that no other man on earth can beat me.
You see, the king of professional wrestling, Harley Race, has accomplished more in his career than you could take 100 wrestlers and jam them together. This man has done it all, and he's continuing to do it all. And one thing will top it off. With this gold crown and this beautiful robe would be one more thing, and that would be that 20 pounds of gold, the world championship around his waist. And sir, it will happen, I guarantee you.
Actually get in the ring, did he?
Yes, he did, and he did very well. I'm absolutely amazed. I can't tell you what it did to me inside to see this man actually overcome all that adversity, still get in the ring, and still wrestle. Oh.
I thought you were going to say how those words tasted. Yeah.
Not very good.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. I talked to Superstar, and he was just delighted with the emotion and delighted to get back in the ring. Right now, Ted DiBiase, Million Dollar Man, at it again.
I'd like the best suite in the house.
Okay, so that'd be the honeymoon suite, and that's been reserved for several months.
Wait. You don't understand. I'm Ted DiBiase, the Million Dollar Man. I have a standing reservation at every major hotel in the world.
I'm sorry, sir, but they've already checked into their suite.
Virgil, I think there's probably been a mistake in reservations, and that suite's in my name.
Sir, I'm sorry. I can't kick them out of their suite.
Virgil, I think we could find them another room, don't you, and give the honeymoon suite to me?
Yes, sir. The honeymoon suite's yours.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Let's go. Let's get out. Out of the room. Let's go, lovebirds. Out.
I'm working.
Mr. DiBiase does not like to be kept waiting. Come on.
What's supposed to happen on my honeymoon?
Well, I don't care. Grab it, baby. Grab your stuff and let's leave.
Let's go. Come on,
grab it. Well, I suppose all of you are upset with me again, and I'm sure you're feeling sorry for this poor honeymoon couple.
Let's go.
Hey, don't be upset feeling sorry for them. 10 years from now, they'll probably want separate rooms. And the hotel clerk, it's not her fault. It's like I've been telling you for a couple of weeks now. Everybody's got a price. She had her price, and you've got your price. Everybody's got a price for me. The Million Dollar Man.
This bout is scheduled for one fall. Introducing in the ring from parts unknown, weighing in at 265 pounds, the Gladiator. The opponent, from Detroit, Michigan, weighing 288 pounds, George the Animal Steele.
George the Animal Steele, the most unorthodox man in professional wrestling today, as the Gladiator tried to attack him right off the bat and got caught.
Why don't they find this man or suspend him?
Oh.
Gladiator one.
Oh. No, George the Animal Steele. He bites people, throws men over the top ropes, uses chairs, bells. Look at this. Watch this. Sounds like a description of you.
Well, it's, and then with him, you fight fire with fire.
And these humanoids sit here and cheer for him. Uh-oh. Going after that fetish of his, the turnbuckle. And there it is. I wonder what it is about that. Oh, Gladiator, the recipient right in the kisser. The animal, I think, is trying to rip the mask off the Gladiator.
Maybe during his childhood, somebody ripped all the hair out of his head.
I think that was caused by some kind of an illness.
There's something wrong with a guy that does that.
Look at the back of his cranium.
Oh, he just about got it off. We're going to get a look at the Gladiator. Who do you think that is under there?
I don't know.
Haku, perhaps.
Not Haku. Oh.
Over the top rope once again. Might be the only thing that... Oh, look at that awesome green tongue. Look at the back of the cranium on the animal. Throwback to the Cro-Magnon man.
It's like Mount Rushmore at sunset.
Yeah. Well, your neck doesn't look too good right now.
No, I'm injured.
Yeah. Tell me about it. You've been telling me about it for a long time.
I'll continue to tell you about it if you keep...
Oh!
Now, there's no padding on that post.
Too bad.
Too bad.
Ramming the elbow right into the bared steel turnbuckle.
You'd make a heck of an attorney.
Oh! Setting him up for perhaps what will be the end. Talking about referring to the flying elbow. Flying hammerlock by George the Animal Steele. Puts that
surprise he knows a hold.
He knows a lot of holds. You'd be surprised.
Now look at this. The ring is a complete mess. He's destroyed one turnbuckle. He's almost broke this man's shoulder. Almost unmasked him. Ran him into the post. Ran him into the rail. And the referee still is letting him continue.
It was a very good scenario you just made. Very proud of you.
You are paying attention. You better pay attention when he's out there. He might come up behind you, jerk you off and backwards.
That's right. Not me. Oh, you maybe. Not me.
Why not? He probably doesn't even know who you are.
Going again, once again, after the mask of the Gladiator. Uh-oh, he's giving it up now. Now he's gone to that flying hammerlock. There it is. It won't take long for the Gladiator to see yet, and he did.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh, he's going after another one.
He had breakfast. Why not lunch? Yes.
Might as well.
Yes. The winner of this bout, George the Animal Steele.
Hey! He knows he won.
What makes his tongue green? Turnbuckle paint?
Possibly. Could be something within his endocrine system that does that.
Well, he should be wormed and put to sleep.
There's a good likeness right there.
There's his mom.
Let's go back and take a look at the flying hammerlock patented hold of George the Animal Steele. Gladiator not wasting any time in calling it quits before he tore something right out.
This is a one-fall bout. Introducing first, from Kansas City, weighing 248 pounds, the ace, Cowboy Bob Orton. The opponent, from New Haven, Connecticut, weighing 240 pounds, Jerry Allen.
Jerry Allen out of New Haven, Connecticut, facing the ace, Cowboy Bob Orton. Gorilla Monsoon here at ringside in the Boston Garden with his lordship, Alfred Hayes, bringing you all the action. Joey Morella, third man in the ring. You're looking at one of the greatest technicians that I know of, Alfred.
Absolutely, but he's going to have his hands full this evening with young Jerry Allen. He is a very, very improved wrestler. His experience in wrestling has only dated back for probably 18 months to 2 years. But he'll show you a lot of moves that are absolutely new. And I wouldn't be at all surprised if Orton comes unstuck in this particular match.
Well, it certainly would surprise me. I don't believe that anybody with less than 5 years' experience inside the squared circle could show Bob Orton anything he hasn't already seen.
Well, I'll have to go along with that, too. But look at this move already that Jerry Allen has made.
Jerry on the outside going to the top turnbuckle. Elbow buster right on top of the cranium.
Very early to go for a high-risk move, and that is a mark of inexperience. However, it paid off for young Jerry Allen.
Nice forward roll to escape that shot.
Good move. Took him down nicely.
Come over.
But couldn't consolidate that position he had.
I think you find, Alfred, if you look at the record books and you check the personalities out over the years, all second-generation wrestlers have done extremely well.
They have indeed, yes. It's bred into them, I suppose. You could talk about breeding here, and he devastated Jerry Allen with that back suplex there. He poised so long in the air, he had Allen perfectly balanced to do maximum damage, and that's what he's good at.
Oh, set him up! But Allen out of there, and he rammed that left shoulder right into the steel post. Well, I don't have to, I know that you're no stranger to Orton Sr., Bob's father. No. What a nasty individual.
Oh, wasn't he a salty old man? Oh, God.
Well, it certainly rubbed off on his offspring.
He could make you pay for your sins, could
Absolutely.
He not?
Absolutely.
made miserable, life miserable for a lot of guys.
He certainly did.
Going to work now on the left arm and shoulder, the ace, the former henchman.
Look
nice
at that.
Nice
good
leverage move.
What a good move that was by Orton. He was in trouble himself, and yet while on his knees he thought that one out and slipped down, and as you say, with all that leverage, took Allen clean through the middle rope.
Referee pushing him back, giving Jerry a chance to get back inside, which was only right.
Yes. Allen very unsteady on his feet there.
Talk about charisma, talk about places with nostalgia. This Beantown, Boston Garden, certainly has that of it.
It does it not? Well, in our chosen career, it has a history that is probably second to none.
Look at this, slingshot, high sunset, but Orton still with his hands on that second rope. Didn't work. Nice idea, but...
Good idea, but didn't go anywhere. Not with Orton. Orton kept that good grip on the middle rope there and wasn't going to be bunched.
Oh, look at that. Just rammed him. Face first. Down into the canvas. That'll rearrange your facial expression for you.
And it could stop you thinking.
And how?
Easy slam by Orton. He's looking very, very confident now.
Look out.
What is he going to do from
here? Spring up into a cover here. Oh, Jerry brought the knees up right at the last moment. Caught him right in the lower abdomen.
Good move by him. He played possum there. He just lay back and let Bob Orton think that he was out, and he wasn't. He was very alert.
Orton now rammed face first. He just missed hitting his face into the steel post. He wants time out.
Yes, and there's a lot of power in this young Allen, too. He's very well put together, and the way he threw Orton into the corner post there, he showed that he has that power.
Drop kick, caught him on his shoulder, forced him
good
back into the
here.
Turnbuckle.
No, he's waiting at a little
way
bit
too
long.
Close to the ropes.
Too close to the ropes.
Referee Joe Morello spotting that immediately. Pile driver, perhaps.
Wasting time.
Well, he's looking for some kind of confirmation. A note, maybe a note from home or something. I don't know. And I
wouldn't be at all surprised if Orton wasn't setting him up now, because those sort of moves don't faze Orton too much.
Absolutely not. He's seen it all.
In fact, it'll be interesting to watch his next minute or two, because I still have that feeling.
Top and drop, inverted, came right out of the corner with it. Set him up, as you stated,
yes,
Alfred. Really
he did.
Set him up.
And Orton's going to keep doing that, too, to this youngster.
The former henchman will make you pay for every mistake.
Yes.
And shoots a mean game of pool as well.
Yes, he does. He does.
Just a nasty person, 24 hours a day.
He has a lot of talents.
Reminds me a lot of the commandant. Jerry Allen in trouble right now on the receiving end.
He plays a harmonica, you know.
He does.
Yes, not very well, but he does play it.
Plays due to a diminishing number of requests.
Look at this. Just one hand. Incredible strength. That sinew strength.
Backbreaker. Well executed and delivered. Oh, goodness. A posing
well,
demonstration.
Forget that, yeah. Bob. But he does have the sinew strength and power that belies that frame.
Leaving a lot to be desired in the posing demonstration.
Yes. Not exactly a Jim Powers.
So glad to see you, Alfred. I know you're well aware of what's going on in the World Wrestling Federation. So happy and really surprised to see the tremendous progress of superstar Billy Graham.
Isn't that amazing?
Unbelievable.
Oh, God. It is absolutely unbelievable.
Here's a guy that they said might not ever walk again. And now he's pushing that heavy iron, that heavy steel, and talking about climbing back into the ring.
Yes, Allen slipped on that rope. Did you see that? He tried to make the corner buckle there.
Superplex coming up.
Oh,
he's setting him up. Whoa. He's got
goodnight. Took him over.
Goodbye, Jerry.
Oh, he didn't even bother to wait for the last three count because he knew he had him.
Jerry Allen
He went for that high-risk move, Gorilla, and his left foot slipped on the apron, and Orton was in there like a flash.
Didn't work.
The winner of this bout, Ace Cowboy Bob Orton.
The mechanic chalking up another one. Here comes the superplex. Once he gets you up in this position, there is no counter at that point.
Pure power. Look at that. Whipped him over.
That's all the body weight.
And you watch this.
Only...
He doesn't even wait for the three. He knows he's got him. Look at that. Look.
Well, it's hard to be humble when you're great.
Yeah.
We'll be back.
All right. As I have stated time and time again, there are so many things happening in the ever-changing world of professional wrestling, and especially here in the World Wrestling Federation. One subject that I would certainly like to take up with my guests at this time, from Montreal, Quebec, in Canada, Raymond and Jacques de Rougeau brothers, is this very volatile tag team situation that we are currently experiencing in the World Wrestling Federation. Jacques, first to you, when you take a look at it, the Hearts right now are at the very top, but there are so many teams that are hot on their heels, including you, the fabulous Rougeau brothers.
Well, you know, Mean Gene, there sure is. And one thing I want to state and I want to make clear. When we first appeared at the World Wrestling Federation, we were saying everywhere on each TV interview, everywhere we went, that good things come to those who wait. And we've been waiting over a year now, a year and a half. We had a few chances, and we came close, and always something happened, whether it was Johnny V that interfered with the Dream Team. Well, there was always a little obstacle towards that World Tag Team title that we are searching for. But we just want to repeat ourselves, and we will say it again, that we're in the gym every day, and we're in the ring every day working out, and we will persist. And the Hart Foundation, always look over your shoulder, because anytime you see the Rougeau brothers in the ring with you guys, you're in any night, any bad night, you may lose those titles, Mean Gene.
All right, Jacques, I appreciate those comments. Raymond, I know one thing. The Hart Foundation certainly has no love lost for you, and for that, I think they're apprehensive. They're concerned. They may even fear the Rougeau brothers because of some of the things they've said about you over the past couple of weeks.
Well, you know, Mean Gene, that's right. All the things that they've been saying about us just proves one thing, is that they are worried. When you don't talk about somebody, it's because you don't really care about them. But when you keep knocking them, you know what they say? Just no matter what you say, good or bad, it doesn't matter. Just get my name right. Well, you see, they get the Rougeau's name very right because they are very worried. You know, Mean Gene, I think one of the main qualities for any athlete is perseverance. And that is one thing my brother and I have, that is perseverance. We will keep going, we will keep fighting, and we will keep climbing until we attain our goal.
All right, I wonder, I know the two of you are from Quebec, you're from the city of Montreal. Sometimes you feel a little more comfortable with the native language. How about a little of French, Jacques, please?
Well, thank you very much for the time. Je voudrais seulement dire que s'il y a du monde qui écoute puis qui entend nos Canadiens français ou qui parlent français, que les Rougeaux ont toujours persisté. Même si ça prenait un an, deux ans, il y a une chose qu'on va dire, c'est qu'à tous les jours, on est dans le gymnase, tous les jours, on s'entraîne fort, et puis le championnat du monde, la Fédération mondiale que les Hart Foundation détiennent en ce moment, on va aller le chercher.
All right. Et vous, Raymond?
Ben, je suis d'accord avec mon frère, on s'en vient vers le top.
I thank you very much. There are a couple of great ones. They are Raymond and Jacques. They are the fabulous Rougeaus, a big part of the World Wrestling Federation.
Well, another exciting hour in here on Wrestling Spotlight. Can you believe Ted DiBiase? He's taking it obviously much too far. Now he's going to the hotel with honeymoon suites.
At first it was a sort of a laughable thing, but now it's really becoming repugnant. He's really doing this too much.
It's getting to the point where you're saying, what is he going to do next?
Yeah, he's becoming a repulsive person with those. Very conceited.
All right, next week we have just an incredible show for you, featuring, among other things, the big pose down between the superstar and the natural Butch Reed. Jake the Snake will be here, Randy Savage, and the title on the line when the Hearts go against the Bulldogs. We've heard that matchup before.
It's going to be my favorite matchup next week. Not because I'm English, don't get that.
Well, what is the reason?
Well, I like the Hearts. I think they're very, very powerful, and I think they can now really establish themselves as a good world-class champion team, which they are, of course, but the world-class bit was missing before.
Okay, we'll see you next week. Lots to go next week. We'll see you then.